Hey folks, and welcome to Drinking With Friends, a podcast where we sit around a table and drink a bunch of beer and stuff. So, my name's Chris.
What up? It's Todd.
I'm Obert.
And I'm Dan.
Woo!
Hey! Very fancy.
This is the second edition of Drinking With Friends.
Yeah.
Or yes. Third edition. Third edition?
Depends on if you donate, give us money on Patreon or not, I guess.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
The super lost episode.
The one.
Are you sure that this is recording through this mic, just an FYI?
Yes. Okay. Yes, I am positive, because I set it up this time, so I know it's correct. But we're all in town for Tud's wedding, which is in a couple days, or a couple days ago, depending on...
depending on when you're listening to this.
Which is next Thursday, so... But, so we have Dan with us, and...
Hi, everybody.
Hey! So Dan is someone that we have known for about 30 minutes.
Yeah. We have this thing about picking up hobos on the side of the road and bringing them to the pod.
Right.
Last week it was Jordan, because Obert was missing, but now we found Obert
on
the side of the road where we dropped Jordan off. And then going down the road, we found this other guy named Dan.
It's a really busy road. A lot of people on the side.
A lot of hobos.
A lot of hitchhikers.
But no, this is true. Dan, we've known you for, what, 20, 30 years?
Yeah, going on 27, 26 years, something like that.
Give or take. So,
plus or minus.
Yeah, plus or minus 30 years.
But yeah, Dan is part of one of the exclusive members of the Rosso Road Club to add to the podcast.
Yeah. We've all officially all lived on the same road at one point in our lives.
Big portion of our lives.
For most of our lives. Most of our lives.
Have you guys talked about this on the podcast yet?
Yeah.
I think there's an episode or two, especially for our true fans who went back and listened to episode zero. I think we talked about how we all grew up on the same road. But for our newer listeners, that's a big part of how we know each other. Spending a lot of time on Lisbon Central School bus 6A.
Yep.
6A.
I remember one time they tried to put me on bus 6, and that was just not, that wasn't happening. I don't know why they did that.
But yeah, I attribute a lot of why I'm friends with you guys. Waiting 30 minutes after school for the bus 6 to drop everybody off, and then come pick us all up.
That's your way of saying this is the only reason you're friends with us is because we're forced into it.
Yeah, come to find out, if you're stuck with people for 30 minutes a day for 5 days a week for 9 years, plus all the time on the bus, you become friends.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Talk a couple times.
Yeah, that's how it goes. Oh man, those bus rides though, they were fun. I remember when Pokemon was big, I used to battle Nick LeBrec. Shout out to him, I'm assuming he listens, but
yeah.
In Pokemon until he got dropped off the bus and we never ended up finishing our battles. So that was pretty fun.
That was a great story.
It was awesome.
Well, yeah, you guys were at the early part of the bus ride.
Yeah.
First couple stops.
Yeah.
We had to go turn around and do all kinds of 7-point turns in the bus before we got dropped off.
Depending on the year, because some years we went up the other way and we dropped Ben off first.
That is true. Yeah. That is true, yeah.
Ben would be that fifth elusive Rosso Road person.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I think that would basically be it. Unless Miss Cawthier, shout out to Miss Cawthier again.
She wants to drink beer.
Why not?
Miss Cawthier, right in. Do you want to drink beer with your students from 20 years ago?
/ roadmates.
Is she still alive?
She wasn't old at all.
Yeah, she's still kicking.
Just barely. The ripe age of 50.
Listen, I remember her being old.
When you're a kid, all teachers seem old.
Right.
But no, yeah. One thing I want to do, being all in the same room, is clink beers and start drinking together. How does that sound?
Yeah. Clink beers.
Sounds great.
Clink beers alone or together with friends.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cheers, everybody.
Audio gold. Congratulations. Yeah. All right. Who wants to start us off this week?
I don't know. Maybe I'll go.
Maybe Ober, who's already cracked his beer.
Yeah, I'm bringing... I got a beer to the pod this week that I picked up at Nebco. We've talked about them before. We've talked about Fuzzy Baby Ducks. I've never been there before.
What's Nebco stand for?
It's Nebco. Great question, Todd. It's New England Brewing Company.
Mm-hmm.
And they used to make a beer called Gandhi Bot. Now it's called G-Bot.
Mm-hmm.
This is a beer called Baby Bot. And it says, this is what you call the unimperialized version of our G-Bot double IPA. It's the same hop blend, just a bit more wee than its big brother. A solid and deliciously hoppy beer that tastes way larger than it is.
Nice.
Yeah. So yeah, this is just a single IPA version.
Fun story about the Gandhi Bot. They got sued by the Indian consulate, and that's why they had to change the name.
Yeah. Yeah, so now it's just G-Bot.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah. So, but yeah, so digging into this baby bot, it's just what I need after a long day of drinking with friends to continue the drinking train.
How much ABV is it?
This guy weighs in at a solid 5.2 ABV, 55 IBUs, Columbus, Simcoe, and Citra hops. It's a smooth, good drinker. I could see why. I think it's not going to be as popular and ever take off as much as the G-Bot has. I think it's a better beer with the double IPA version than the single IPA, but I appreciate a toned-down beer every once in a while. I think G-Bot, or Gandhi Bot at the time, was the first double IPA I ever had.
Interesting.
So, yeah. Yeah, it was at Hammonasset. Brought a six-pack.
It was part of that elusive group of, like, Sip of Sunshine and Heady Topper and Focal Banger back in the day before, like, there were all these IPAs out there.
Sure. But, like, of those, the only one that you could really find around here
was
Gandhi Bot.
Yeah, but it was that same and thing Sip. Where you could go in and buy, like, a four-pack, and that was it.
Or,
like,
in certain cases, a can.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're 12-ounce cans, so.
Yeah, but I remember trying it and be like, wow, this is a totally different beer. But with all of my thoughts on Baby Bot, I would say this is a solid 3.75 for me.
Okay.
Which 3.75 puts it solely in the would order again, but would there's probably other stuff on the menu that's more suited to me.
Right. Sure.
Yeah.
So what do you think the Untappd world thinks of this?
Well, that's a great question. Mm. I'd probably say I'm around par, maybe 3.65.
Surprisingly not. So out of the 3,300 check-ins, the average is a 3.96.
Okay, so it's a popular beer.
Yeah, it's got a little bit of that hop hype being NEPCO, but...
For sure.
Have we had a NEPCO beer on the podcast before? I don't think we have.
I don't think we have.
Which is kind of crazy because we've talked about it a number of times, but NEPCO's like the staple from Connecticut. Like,
yeah, it's the OG.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
right.
They're like, we talked about Thomas Hooker. Yep. They were like one of the first local canned, local distributed brews in Connecticut.
Yeah.
Sure.
So did you say that you went to the brewery?
I did, and you know what? It was my first time going there. It's, you kind of get off the highway in New Haven, you take a left, right, left, you know, drive all these crazy Connecticut roads, which I'm still readjusting to.
Yeah.
Well, it's a nice little tasting room. It was hot as heck outside. It was hot as balls because I decided to come to Heat Wave when Chris decided to bring all the heat up from North Carolina with him.
That's right.
But it was a cool little spot. They had triple fuzzy baby ducks, which is a little much for me,
nice.
But it was good on tap.
Nice.
Yeah, they had some really good stuff. They had a Paloma Sour, which I enjoy. And, you know, it's not somewhere I would say is a must drink spot. I wouldn't say you have to go and invite all your friends to go check out the tasting room. But I also picked up some Spin Cycle from them, which is their single hop series called Spin Cycle because they're always changing what's in it.
What number are they up to?
21.
Nice.
Yeah. And yeah, it's a good spot. And I'm glad I finally made the pilgrimage even after I left the state. It was tough with so many breweries in Connecticut to just pick a few to go see when I'm here. But it was worth it for sure.
Yeah, I remember when I first went there, they used to give out free beer. I don't think they give out free beer anymore. But you used to be able to just go there and drink all the beer you wanted
in the
tap room. And that was not too long ago. It was only like 3 or 4 years ago. It was before they redesigned their tap room to be what it is today.
Yeah, we've talked on the pod too about breweries that do flights and don't do flights and how Fox Farm, you can do the half pours. Same thing here, where they don't do a flight. You just have to order a half pour. But they will pour you samples. So that was good. But enough about NEPCO. I know we have three other beers to get to today.
Yeah, okay, I'll go next. So, I'm drinking something that I was lucky enough to win from a giveaway on Instagram.
Ooh.
Yes. Nice. Our friends at the Beer Travel Guide had a giveaway, and I just happened to enter and win, which was nice.
Okay, important question.
Yes.
Was this on the DAWF Instagram account, or was this on the Colts Instagram account?
So
This is a valid question.
The Colts official Instagram.
What are you Colts?
Colts 1287.
Colts 1287.
Yeah.
Because you're born December 87.
So right? This was actually one where you have to... So this is one where you actually had to go onto a website and enter information.
Oh.
So you had to enter in like your email or Instagram handle or something and your name. So
did your email win or did dawfpodcast@gmail.com
win? I only entered once and I don't remember what I put in. Well, it wasn't email. It was Instagram handle. I think I put the dawfpodcast handle. But...
So this is like a third of my beer and a third of Obert's beer.
Let's just say as when you put in as much time and effort into the Instagram as I have, you can start claiming beers.
Yeah, I've said that before. I've said that Chris does the Instagram work, so I think Chris gets the sweet liquid rewards.
And I did bring them to share, so...
I didn't hear that, so that's even a perk for me.
This is new news to me.
No. You knew this. But anyways.
Chris brings the new news.
Hashtag new news. So this is Pine Berry. It's a milkshake-style double IPA brewed with pineapple, strawberry, and vanilla. It's from Mumford Brewing, which is out of Los Angeles, California, the home of LeBron James, best player ever to play for the Lakers. And we're going to go ahead and try it out. A lot of fruity goodness on the nose, I'll tell you that much.
Nice, yeah, pretty lively can you got here. But what do you think?
Really good. I mean, it's very sweet. There's a lot of different flavors happening. I get a lot of strawberry with a little bit of pineapple. You can definitely tell that the lactose is in there, as well as some of the vanilla, just to mellow out some of the 8.6% alcohol. It's not very bitter. At least to me, it's not. I don't get a ton of bitterness. But other than that, it's a pretty solid beer. Easy drinker. Good for those hot summer days, because everybody knows the one thing you want when it's hot outside is a nice big glass of milk.
Oh, yeah. When the sun starts beating down and you just can't get enough of those milkshakes.
I'm staring at the can right now, and it says, brewed with pineapple, strawberry, and vanilla, and it's vegan.
It is vegan.
Yes. It's
a bonus. Yeah.
It is a bonus, yes, I guess.
You don't want none of that meat beer.
I mean, meat beer would probably be pretty... No, it'd probably be gross.
What would make a normal beer not?
I don't know. We've talked about this before.
Cheese?
Yeah, I guess...
No. There's an enzyme that is made from animals, I think. They use it, or there's something they use to filter. We've talked about it on the pod before.
The best part about this is that this is a milkshake beer. So therefore, you would think it has lactose in it. Does that make that... Lactose isn't vegan.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. You can derive lactose from non-dairy. Just like...
Interesting.
Yeah.
So, but anyways, it's a solid beer, even though it's vegan. I'll probably give this a... I'll probably stick with the 375 on it. It's a lot happening all at once. It's very fruity, very sweet. I like mine a little bit more bitter than this, but solid beer. So,
what do you think the untapped rating is for this beer?
3.87.
Out of 348 check-ins, it is actually rated at 4.0.
Okay, all right. Nice. I'm a little low, but it's a good beer. I'd drink it again, but that's it. Thank you to the Beer Travel Guide for hooking me up.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, let's have our guest Dan jump in here.
Yeah, thanks, Obert. I'll give a shout out to Chris here. Thank you for providing me with this beer for today. Today I'm drinking the Lemon Haze Pale Ale from Primal Brewery in Huntersville, North Carolina, which I believe is right near where you live now, Chris?
Yeah, it's about 30 minutes from my house.
And as Chris would tell us, it's not Huntersville, it's Huntersville.
Huntersville. Yeah.
You can't pronounce the I.
No, you do.
Us New Englanders talk weird, so. So this is a Lemon Haze Pale Ale. It's a combination of a pale ale and wheat beer, both of which I very much enjoy, with lemon drop hops, perhaps a new hoppy hour segment. This beer has a bright lemon flavor and ample hop bitterness, coming in at 6.1%, so pretty stout on the ABV, and 40 IBUs. So let's give this guy a shot.
I like the can art.
I was just going to say that. Yeah, it's like a psychedelic hippie with... bright yellow glasses.
So yeah, I would say the description on the can here is actually quite accurate. Definitely get the ample hop bitterness all the way through with like that bright lemon kind of right in the beginning. So kind of like it hits you with almost like, oh, this is kind of going to be a shandy type beer, but then the hops like kick in right away and you're like, nope, this is more pale ale-ish type of beer.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, so this is actually pretty good. I like it. I like the crispness of that lemon. And I think like really cold, like a 4-pack of this would go great at the beach.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah. Like, is this a summer crushable?
Yeah, yeah, for sure. I think it would get dangerous being 6.1%. Because, yeah, I can definitely see myself drinking a few of these. Also being a 16-ounce beer. This is pretty good. I would go 375 on this one. For sure would buy this. I've obviously never seen this before, not being from North Carolina, but for sure. I'll say, Chris, gotta send some of these up my way.
Yeah, definitely will. Yeah, Primal is a pretty good spot. We went there a couple weekends ago, and they are a really nice brewery, and they have a nice space, a lot of outdoor space, which, you know, it's hot here, but it's always hot in North Carolina.
Have we talked about them on the pod?
I think we did maybe a little bit ago. I touched on them.
Now that you talk about that outdoor space, I remember that was being the highlight of your review last time.
Yeah, but they're relatively new. I lied.
Well, the can says since 2013, right?
Well, relatively new if you think of space, like the space-time continuum as one long strand.
Since the beginning of time till now, they're relatively new.
Right.
On a scale of 0 to 13.7 billion, they're like a 13.699999.
Okay. but they're a nice spot. Definitely worth checking out. And I do enjoy that beer quite a bit.
So, nice. Dan, what do you think the untapped rating would be of this?
I would probably say maybe a little bit higher than what I rated it. Maybe like a 3.9.
And Chris, as the only other person on the pod who's had this beer, what do you think it's rated?
I just looked, so I cheated.
Oh, well then you're disqualified.
Well, I want
you have to
leave
the room now.
I was actually curious what I rated it, which I rated it the same as Dan. So
yes, but you have to leave the room now. You've been disqualified. You've been voted off the island. Get out.
I'm taking my microphone with me.
It's okay. We have other mics. So the untapped rating is 3.41.
Oh wow, that's pretty low. Yeah, so I'm surprised.
People were not a fan of this beer. Well, I mean, I guess in the grand scheme of things, they are just not as big of a fan as other beers.
That's like one of the lowest averages we've had, I think.
Yeah, I think this might clock in as close to, if not the lowest average, since we started doing this.
Yeah, 3 weeks ago.
Now, does Untappd as an app give any guidance as to what a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is?
No.
No.
It's totally up to
purely user's choice.
For all we know, we've been rating them wrong, and Untappd really wanted, you know, 0.25 to be
the highest.
Could you imagine? Like,
oopsies. ever since Roger Ebert gave his favorite movie 0 stars.
Yeah, that is funny. I don't know why it's a 3.41. Honestly, I mean, I could see maybe it going to a 3.5, but it's a solid beer. I like it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, Ted, you can't deprive us any longer. Please give us your rating here. What are you drinking?
My rating. I haven't even drank the beer yet to tell you.
What's your rating?
So this week I am drinking I don't know if it's pronounced Melcher or Melker Street India Pale Ale by Trillium. It's one of their Street Series IPAs. 7.2% ABV.
Nice. I've had this one actually. I remember it being really good.
Yeah, me too.
I mean, it is Trillium, so it's probably pretty good. I know that it's made with Mosaic and Columbus hops, so it's their Mosaic beer of the Street Series.
Put it this way: you talked about it last week about how they have a bunch of different beers at the brewery, and as soon as you said Melcher Street, I remember that beer. So it left a very distinct impression on me, even for a Trillium beer. It left a distinct impression.
That's a really good beer. A lot of melon, a little bit of pine.
Would you say cantaloupe?
Water. Honey.
Probably like a cross between a honeydew and a cantaloupe. That's why I said melon and not like a particular melon.
It's knee-deep in fruit salad over here.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm working on this. I mean, there's a little bit of grapefruit on the back end.
Mm. That's probably the most prominent citrusy note.
Yeah. I mean, there's even a little bit of peach in there. And, you know, and there's definitely some tangerine on the nose. I like it. Overall, I mean, it's a solid. I think this is the first time I've had the Melcher Street.
Yeah.
We got to figure out how to pronounce this road.
You know what?
They get it.
Yeah, they get it. You want? Why don't you spell it for the listeners so they can Google it?
Nah.
N-E-L-C-H-E-R.
Overall, no, it's pretty good. I like this beer a lot. You know, Columbus is not my favorite hop to go with, but this one comes across pretty good. I'd give this a solid 4.
Nice.
Okay.
You know what? So people have given you a hard time in the mailbag and on the podcast about your fruit descriptions. And you gave us like a solid 6 fruits in here.
Yeah, there's a solid fruit salad going on in here.
I think being drinking with friends, I think we have a rare opportunity for the co-hosts to confirm, see how your fruit descriptions line up.
Okay. Here you
go. Right? Okay. I don't know if this is a pod first, but you said a lot of fruit, so I'm gonna just try and think of the fruit flavors I get out of this as I smell it and as I drink it.
And you will notice that there was no star fruit in this description because I did not taste star fruit. I tasted melon.
Fun fact though, when I got here, the first thing that Tud's Caitlin hands me is a star fruit polar seltzer, which I really appreciate.
Now you know what star fruit tastes like.
Yeah, so aroma-wise, I get strawberry, and I definitely see, first, right as it hits the front of your tongue, I definitely get a lot of those, almost like a lighter berry flavors. I think like strawberries and cream, almost. And yeah, I see what you're talking about with the melon, now that I...
Which melon is it, Obert?
The green one, the honeydew. I think I get a light honeydew, and actually, quick tangent in the middle of the episode here. There's at the farmer's market near me, there's people who sell melons that I've never seen anywhere else before. I forget what they're called now. I'll let you know. No, it's this like white scaly one. Yeah. I think it's called like, it's something like angelic or heavenly or something like that.
Jackalope.
A jackalope melon. No, but I'll report back in future episodes. But yeah, I definitely get that very almost cloyingly sweet fruit at the front end.
Yeah. It's good.
you're not going to try to guess the fruit?
Yeah, I don't get as much strawberry as Obert was saying, but I don't know, maybe it's because I was just drinking the strawberry.
That's true. Beer. Yeah, everybody's coming from a different palate spot.
Right. I get a little bit of, oddly enough, a little bit of like pine almost.
That's what you Todd said, okay. Pine.
All right. And
I was just looking for fruits here.
Yeah. Oh, true. Yes. Yeah. Okay, fair.
I get a lot of melon and pine and a little bit of like peachiness.
Pine fruit. I can see the melon, and, like you were saying, the sweetness. I can't really grab the peach myself, but that doesn't mean anything because apparently my palate's a little dumb. So, but no, I mean, I like this beer. I had it a while ago, but very good beer.
But I will say, you know, for our listeners who've said, hey, Todd, you've said a lot of fruits, I'm going to back them up on this one. I got those fruits. I thought that was a really pretty apt description there.
See, the listeners need to trust me when I start to go on my fruit salad spin.
I have to say, in the past, I've been one of those listeners.
Of course you have.
And tasting that beer just now.
We got an in-person mailbag right here.
Tasting that beer makes me realize that my beer palate is underdeveloped. But just looking up the description of this beer on Beer Advocate, it mentions mango, earthy pine. Mm. It mentions grapefruit. It mentions tropical fruit / melon and peach. So literally, I think
everything
Tud just said is in the Beer Advocate description.
Tud Cleo does not lie.
So well done, Tud.
Yeah, that was.
Gotta hand that one to you.
That was good. And you said it was a 4 on your scale, right?
I gave it a 4.
Okay, so
I'm gonna guess Untappd is higher than me.
Untappd is higher than you. Yes,
probably a 4.18.
4.29.
Ooh.
So that's the highest I think overall rating
we've had on here, and I think you know. We'll have to check the record books, but based on how I said I remember this beer, I wouldn't be surprised if I gave it a 4.5 back in the day.
I gave it a 4.25, I can tell you that.
So yeah, this is my first time having this beer. I had never had it before, so I thought I would obviously pick it up and try it. I'm actually pretty happy that I did. This is delicious.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, so are you almost out of Trillium beers? Everybody's dying to know.
I don't know. Are we getting a lot of complaints about drinking too much Trillium?
No. No one's complained. Just know this is your third one in a row.
Well, when I go in the fridge and I look at the beers in there and I'm like, well, I've drank a lot of Fox Farm. I've drank a lot of Treehouse.
Fair.
And Trillium is like my newest beers, so I just bring those on.
Yeah, I think Chris has been the most diehard in terms of self-enforcing the one beer per brewery rule.
Yep. I don't know.
But even I haven't done back-to-back-to-back.
Listen, I think over the next few weeks, you will notice that I probably will not drink a Trillium or a Treehouse or a Fox Farm beer.
Yeah, well, yeah, I'm throwing down the gauntlet at my own feet, and I'm saying, next podcast I'm in Montana for, I'm doing a cocktail, because I've been on the beer stretch for too long. I gotta bring something other than beer back to the show.
Yeah, I think we all could use that. So just a small break from beer, because I don't do overly well with hard alcohol. But
so all right, after we have all praised...
Hang on, one more second in my defense. Had I have had my North Carolina beers before this week, I would have drank those beers on this pod.
That is true.
I had not received them until somebody arrived at my house.
Right. So you have them.
And
so
I need to make room in my fridge to put them in there.
Right.
Hence, I'm drinking the drinks.
So I arrived a million days ago, and we've recorded two podcasts since then. You could have literally had them, both of the episodes.
And I... Not to come too much to Chris's defense, because I have also been craving these North Carolina beers. But at the very least he hasn't been flaunting the burials and the Funkatoriums by reviewing them without either of us.
That is true. He has not done that.
He's refrained.
I just want to point out that if you want to start calling me out for Trillium beers, I'm going to call you out for not bringing the non-Trillium beers I could have been drinking on the podcast.
You have all you have is Trillium in your house?
A Treehouse and Fox Farm.
Okay. I'm segueing here.
Segue.
Okay. You guys, I noticed you guys missed me on the last episode because I'm gonna keeping this train moving.
Nope. We're turning the Joe Rogan week, up in this bitch.
This week, after praising Tud's Toucan Sam nose here of being able to pick out all those fruits, I have a bit of a challenge for you this week, Tud. You know, being that you're getting married, and this is something that all four of us can join in here.
Okay.
But I really want to test your knowledge here.
Ogre, you were telling us about a challenge?
Yeah. So this is Dan inspired. I gotta give Dan credit. But we always talk, Tud, what's your favorite beer?
I don't know. What's my highest rated beer on tap?
I know what your highest rated beer on tap is.
Is there going to be a Bud Light coming out of this?
Tud, we got a bit of a challenge for you today, okay?
Oh,
I just revealed a Bud Light, all right?
Just for the listeners, because I know this is an audio medium and not a visual medium, it's a giant Bud Light.
Don't worry about the size.
It's 40 ounces. It's 40 ounce Bud Light.
It's a 25 ounce Bud Light.
Oh, okay.
Tud's real good. Hopefully, Tud's better at flavor identification than volumes, because we're going to do something a little special today. We're going to see if Tud can tell the difference.
Oh, Jesus.
We got a Coors Light. Oh, man. We got a Miller Light.
Oh.
We got a Busch Light. And they got a Pabst Blue Ribbon.
Ooh.
Nice.
So what's
the best
favorite
one.
Favorite award-winning beer.
So what we're going to do... Yeah, our favorite blue bourbon beer. So what we're going to do is we're gonna pour these into glasses, and we're going to see how you stack up, Tud. If you really are good at identifying your beloved Bud Light.
He's so nervous right now. You see his face.
I am completely unsure of my ability to do this.
Uh-oh.
All right, so we're going to take a break. We'll be back with live. All right, so we're back. We have poured our various beers. Again, for our listeners, it's PBR, Busch, Coors Light, Bud Light, and Miller Light.
I just love the fact that at the table, right next to my line of beers, is sitting my can of Milker Street and my glass that still has beer in it.
Tell you what, we'll throw that one in there too.
Yeah, I don't know if you're going to be able to tell which one that one is.
Oh, I'm at least going to get one right.
Okay, but yeah, I think we got to start with Tud, and then I think we should all see if we know.
Okay.
If we can figure them all out.
All right.
Okay. Smells like lager. Smells like lager.
You don't
that
say.
One, that one has less smell. That's an interesting
less one. Smelly. Number two is less smelly, folks.
Smells the same. Smells the same.
Where all those fruits now, Tud?
That one smells skunky.
Okay, so which one do you think that one is?
I don't know. I haven't tasted it.
Five is skunk.
All right. Number one.
All right, so number one, let's start with this.
Hang on. Before you start, Tud, can I ask you a question?
Of course.
You love Bud Light.
I do.
How confident are you that you're going to be able to?
Who loves Bud Light?
Is it true?
Todd loves Bud Light.
How confident are you in your ability to pick Bud Light out of this crowd?
I thought I was going to be really confident in it based on like look and smell. After looking and smelling, I have to say I'm not as confident as I once was. Yeah. But by taste, I should be able to taste it. I mean, or else my entire life is a lie.
Not to question the foundation of your entire beer knowledge.
Correct.
But we're going to do
and
that
we just
right
heard
now
on this pod how good I was at labeling fruit coming out of this beer.
That was exactly how I led into the segment.
So just to be clear here, we have 5 beers, we have 5 glasses, so we can see them, and then we have 5 solo cups, different orders.
So this is a real test, is one, can Todd identify the Bud Light, and two, can you do it twice?
Wait, what?
Meaning, you could get lucky here. We're going to say, can you get lucky twice?
Oh, okay. All right. So I got to, okay.
Wait, so 1 through 5 is not the same 1 through 5?
No.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay. I don't know what Dan labeled his 1 through 5, and Dan doesn't know what I labeled my 1 through 5.
Correct.
Oh.
So that's how we're able to both
So we can
play.
Still somewhat participate.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'll tell you instantly off the bat that 1 is the most bubbly out of them all. It's still bubbling. So the rest of them are kind of still. This one, not so much.
I see a lot of bubbles.
That could also be the glass.
In all of them.
That is right?
True. All right. Going for the first sip here.
This is audio.
Scale of 1 to 5, where 5 is definitely a Bud Light, and 1 is absolutely not a Bud Light. What do you think for these so far?
I think they taste a lot of the same.
So both are 4.5s? Okay.
Both are Bud Light so far.
So 1 and 2 are the same thing.
Well, the listeners in here, secretly Dan poured all Bud Light. Seems like you're really a tell.
Isn't the trick that they would all not be Bud Light?
Oh, really? I feel like Coors Light's very distinctive.
Right.
But apparently not.
Got the first 5 sips in.
What are they?
What are we thinking?
Okay, it's the same.
Oh no!
Okay, well, you know what? I'll help you out here. We gotta jump in here.
Oh, you don't know this game.
I only know the solos. I don't know the glasses.
Okay, yeah.
I'll play the solos then.
Yeah, everybody but me. Okay. And I guess Todd should be drinking from the solos because that's why I filled.
All right, so I got 4.
Oh, number 1, definitely Bud Light. Okay. Number 2, less Bud Light than 1, but still kind of Bud Light. But I'm still not outranking Bud Light. I'm going to say number 2 is Coors. Is my thought here.
This is Busch. Number 5 is Busch, I think. That's my first guess. That's my guess as of this second.
3 might be Coors.
I got my Coors Light.
Don't draw your don't add your opinion to my opinion.
Oh, you weren't talking, so that's why we're jumping in here. We got to get some theories here.
Yeah, I think 5. I mean, taste 5.
Okay. All right. You think 5 is Busch?
Yeah.
I think so the theory on that is it's the only non-light beer.
Yep.
I think it's the PBR. I think 5 is the PBR.
Number 2
it smells
solo.
Skunky. Mm. It tastes skunky.
When you say that, what I'm most confident on is number 5 is PBR for me. That's what I'm putting my
That's Coors Light.
Solo 2?
That's what I think. Mm-hmm. Wait.
This is Miller. 4 Miller Light.
Okay. I got 2 guesses down for Ted here. It's going backwards.
3. Coors Light.
3 is Coors Light? Let me see it. Okay. I poured a bunch in these glasses.
Now they all taste like Coors Light.
I could see it. So to me, warm Coors Light always has had a little bit of a bad apple, like a mealy apple. I get that a little bit with 3.
These two are difficult.
Where's number 5?
I've got Paps and Bud Light left.
Okay.
Paps is 1, Bud Light's 2.
I think I started off saying that.
I have zero confidence in any of my answers, but that's what I'm going with.
All right, so Todd, you got number 1 at PBR, number 2 at Bud Light, number 3 at Coors, number 4 at Miller Lite, number 5 Busch.
Correct.
So Todd and Brendan have both put in their guesses for our glasses, where mm-hmm. we can see them.
All right, so number 1, Todd thought was?
PBR.
And I thought was?
Bud Light.
And the true beer was?
Coors Light.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Wow.
Okay.
So number 2.
Todd thought was
Bud Light.
I thought was
Miller Light.
The real beer is
Bud Light.
He knows his Bud
Light. Yeah, he knows his Bud Light.
20% chance. Yeah. He gets it. That bastard. Number 3, we both thought Coors. That was the Miller Light.
Okay.
So they are made by the same company. Let's put that out there.
Yeah.
This is true.
True.
I think they're all made by the same company, except for
these two, same company. So Miller Lite, Coors Light, same company. Bud Light, Busch Light, same company. Or Bud Light and Busch, same company. Separate.
Right. PBR separate. Okay.
Right.
I thought InBev owned all of Anheuser-Busch and Coors Miller.
No.
Okay.
Number four, Todd guessed Miller, Brandon guessed Busch. That was the PBR.
Oof. Oh, I was so sure on PBR for five.
Todd guessed number five was Busch. That was his first guess. He was pretty certain of that. And Brandon guessed PBR, and it was in fact the Busch.
So I went 0-5. Todd went 2-5.
Todd went 2-5. He got pretty much the most beer in the Busch, and he got his beloved Busch.
All right.
Damn him.
Let's see how Chris does.
Do we want to go straight for the Bud Light reveal, or do we want to build up to it?
Well, let's just go 1-5.
1-5. Okay.
All right.
Number one. I said was Busch. Todd said was PBR. Chris said Miller Lite.
It's Coors.
Damn it. All right.
Both wrong.
All of us wrong.
So that's five wrong Coors identifications out of four people.
No one could get Coors.
Yeah.
So remember. Hang on.
I think one's over this.
Coors. So that's a sweet one. Okay. So Coors is sweet.
Number two, Chris and I both said Coors, so we know that's wrong. Todd said number two was Miller Lite.
PBR.
PBR.
Hmm.
All right. Number three.
Oh, that's really sweet.
The PBR. Interesting. Number three, I guess Bud Light. Todd guessed Coors, which we know is wrong now, and Chris said PBR, which we know is wrong. So number three.
Number three is Miller Lite.
Miller Lite.
Wow.
All right. With two left on the table, Todd's Bud Light guess is still live.
Still a possibility.
It's still live right now that he goes 2-2 with his Bud Light. Three was Miller Lite.
And the first one was
and four and five were both guesses. So I'm over five already based on the results. Todd and Chris both guessed number four was Busch.
And both guessed number five.
And both guessed number five was Bud Light.
Well, I have to tell you, you're both correct.
Whoa!
Todd went 2-2. Bud Light champion. But if anybody ever doubted Todd's ability to prove it.
To drink Bud Light.
I was nervous.
Oh my God. Right.
But yeah. There is a distinct difference. I mean, it just tastes different. And it's probably because I've drank gallons of it, so I can pick it up out of the ones made by Miller Coors are really, really sweet.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the PBR is kind of sweet, and the Busch Light is kind of skunky, so there's just a little bit of a different taste. But these two, I mean, try them. I mean, they're...
So, when you say these two, you mean the Coors.
The Coors, the Miller Light are just...
A little too sweet.
Here, taste that.
Number three.
So this is what I wanted to ask, and obviously you're going to stick with your guns here, but would you say of these five, the Bud Light was your favorite?
Of course.
Yeah.
Well, aside from the Busch, he was accurate with the Bud Light. He was accurate with the Busch both times, accurate with the Bud Light both times, not with the other ones.
Right.
Right. So he obviously has that palate for Bud Light and was able to pick up.
How about you guys? What was your favorite of the five?
Honestly, I had such a hard time. I was flat out guessing for the most part.
Yeah, but which was your favorite?
Yeah, because there are differences.
We have five cups. Everybody has to drink one, and we have a fifth one that we should probably just pour into the others because we can't tell the difference. But if you had to pick one, you're going to have to finish.
Yeah. So actually, both times I guessed Bud Light, but was actually the Miller Light. So I would, from that perspective, because I normally would buy and drink Bud Light if I...
You're a Bud Light guy.
Buying a Bud Light, or buying a light beer, I would buy a Bud Light. So I guess maybe I actually like Miller Light better.
Yeah.
Who knows? So yeah, give me the...
And Chris, your favorite was?
I really didn't have one. They were all so close.
So you tasted?
That's of course. I definitely enjoyed the Anheuser-Busch set better than the rest of them. That includes...
the Busch Light, too?
Yeah. I enjoyed both of them more so than the other three. So.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie. When I thought of this idea, it was almost specifically to make Todd wrong about how much he likes Bud Light. But I'm impressed right now with him and his damn fruit, and then with his Bud Light. He knocked it out of the park today.
Yeah,
for sure.
I feel like I should take the Cicerone, guys.
Maybe.
Just blind. Just go
ahead. Maybe that's the first question they ask you.
can you do this? Yes, I can.
Yeah.
Can you drink five beers, get most of them wrong, but still pick out the Bud Light? Yup. Got it.
Got it.
Count me in.
Hey, you know what? I think I got the highest percentage right out of all out of the four of us, too.
You did. And actually, I'm glad you asked, because, yeah, my favorite was number five, which was, I identified it as PBR, but it was actually, what was it, Dan?
Five was the Bud
Light. Oh, of the original.
Oh, the original? Five was the Busch.
Yeah, I liked the Busch the best, surprisingly enough.
Yeah.
Anheuser-Busch product. I mean, I used to drink Busch Light.
You know what?
Back before I got a little bit of cash and I said, hey, you know what? Maybe I'll just upgrade to Bud Light.
I was a Keystone boy before I graduated to a craft beer man. And I never really experienced the Busch line of products. And maybe it's just because this isn't a light beer. It's just a full-bodied beer. I've been a PBR fan.
So do me a favor. Okay. Drink. Take a sip of that.
Okay.
Take a sip of that.
For those of you who can't see what that's
yeah, visual about. Medium here. No, take a sip of the Busch Light that you like.
Okay.
And then take a sip of the Bud Light. They are similar. I think the Busch Light's slightly skunkier.
It is skunkier, but I kind of like it, which is weird.
That's fine. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you just want to have a pet skunk in your house, it's cool with me.
Yeah, I mean, I'm drinking light domestic adjunct beers. I expect some skunkiness. Yeah.
So I'm going to take the rest of this 24-ounce Bud Light.
Yeah, so as a prize, Todd gets to finish the Bud Light.
Well done, Todd.
Yeah.
I actually was really nervous about the fact that, like, I was going to be like, oh, I really like Coors Light. Like, and then I'd be like, oh, shit, I got to buy Coors Light from now on. But I'm actually pretty excited that this came through. Because, I'm cool with PBR. The thing is, and I don't know if you guys got this or not, and nobody seems to have agreed with me or not. I found a lot of the other beers, maybe besides the Busch Light, because there was a little bit of skunkiness to it, sweeter. And they, by a lot, too. Like, I got, I'm going to go down a path here. I got a lot of flavor of sweetness, and I just wonder, we can go to the advertising campaign, if that's because there's no corn syrup.
No. This is bullshit.
We have your shipment of high fructose corn syrup.
Taste that, and tell me they're not. Tell me there's not a sweetness.
You know what? I didn't say anything on your first one because it's like, you know, everybody's palate is different, but I didn't get that. I don't know. What do you guys think?
I got a lot of sweetness. Yeah. And keep in mind,
I know outside, what you got. No, but what did you guys?
Outside of the beer, I don't drink sodas. I don't drink things with high fructose corn syrup. So.
Okay. At all, including his beer.
Including my beer.
Okay, but Todd, other than you, what did you guys think? Get the whole sweetness thing?
I didn't, no. I find that the Miller Lite and the Coors Light have less flavor. The Bud Light, the PBR, and the Busch had more flavor, but I was not able to distinguish between those.
Well, the PBR and the Busch were the only two non-light beers.
For sure.
There's
no PBR as far as I'm aware.
Yeah. But no, yeah, I did not get the whole sweet versus non-sweet.
That was the one thing.
And honestly, Chris was drinking a milkshake IPA. That's a sweet beer. I wouldn't say any adjunct beer tastes sweet.
No high fructose corn syrup.
I hate to be the guy that agrees with Ted, but I actually can taste the difference. I think they are a little sweeter than the Bud Light.
Yeah.
Personally. But like Obert was just alluding to, I just finished a milkshake IPA. So I did take quite a few swigs, but... I don't know. I've been a Bud Light guy more so than a Coors Light guy, but even then,
come ride this train. Chugga chugga whoop whoop.
Well, that's all you're going to do for chuggas?
That's all I'm doing.
That's all the chuggas.
That's a fast moving train.
Get out of the way. I'm coming.
We can't wait any longer to blow that whistle, baby. You know?
But I mean, in the song, isn't it chugga chugga whoop?
Yep. Yeah.
I mean, that's what they do in I'm drawing a blank on the name of the train. Or the name of the song.
Thomas the Tank Engine?
No. It's like...
Train
Thomas and Friends.
No, it's like the rap song.
Talking to the wrong people.
Okay, so with...
Yeah, they rap about Thomas and Percy and all that. Yeah, right. I know that song.
With one last taste of the Coors Light and the Bud Light back to back, I feel like the Coors Light leaves some slightly off-putting aftertaste. I can't really explain it, but there's something that lingers where the Bud Light, once it goes down... It kind of just all goes away.
Yeah.
You know what my biggest takeaway from this is? I can't tell the difference. They're all the same, and I'll just buy whatever one. And I have zero loyalties to any adjunct beer at this point because they are whatever.
Gallon of gas going for the cheapest one?
Exactly. It's a Shell mobile debate. It's like, I go to whatever gas station. I got no loyalties there. No. That's how I feel about Coors and Bud after this whole taste trial.
Oh, well, I don't feel the same way, so I'm just going to drink this Bud Light.
Okay.
I think Tud takes home the championship belt.
He does.
The Bud Light championship belt?
For sure.
Should I get up and do the Aaron Rodgers?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So for those of you who are at home, Tud stood up. He made like a seatbelt buckle commercial thing from the State Farm commercial. So just so you know.
Yeah.
From the State Farm commercial. I love that. Yeah. That's how you know that.
That's where it's from.
Yeah. It's from the State Farm commercial.
Can we drink good beer again?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Yeah. Okay. So let's move on to how we almost end every episode of Drinking with Friends.
Drinking more beer?
Where we drink one good beer and pass it all around. And see what we each think of it, because we can't do that when we're drinking alone with friends.
That is true.
Yeah. Like so this. Yeah. So this is a fun, happy beer because a good friend of the podcast. Oh,
is that what we're calling the segment? Happy beer.
Happy beer. Yeah.
I like it. Yeah. Okay. Welcome to Happy Beer.
Happy Beer.
Happy Beer. The feature segment on Drinking with Friends.
Yeah. So today's happy beer actually comes to us from the great state of Georgia. We have.
I feel like we should drink two happy.
Too happy? Is it because I put two beers on the table?
Yes.
You know what? I think that's a great idea.
Listen, I've drank a lot of these light beers right now, so like.
So you're ready for two happy beers?
I'm really ready for
all
two
these
beers.
Unhappy beers.
All these unhappy beers.
Well, I mean, we're gonna finish recording, and we're gonna have some beer to drink.
We're gonna have some happy beers. So
unhappy. There's a whole half a bush. 40.
You can dump
that. This is Obert's favorite beer. Here you go, Obert.
Thank you.
You can
thank
dump you. That down the garbage. No. So one of our listeners was nice enough to send us a mix 7-pack. Thank you, Brandon. From his great state of Georgia. Because we talked in the pod and we haven't had a lot of Georgia beers. And also he just loves the podcast and wanted to congratulate Tud on his wedding. So a lot of stuff going on in this mixed care package. So.
Wow, that's nice of Brandon.
Yeah.
Thank you, Brandon.
Thanks, Brandon.
Follow him on Instagram, at Craft Handler. He's written into the show a couple times, but good friend of the pod. He sent us in a couple beers that we'll be drinking the rest of the night, but we wanted to highlight a couple of them. The first one is from Creature Comforts Brewing, and it's called their Creature Stout, which is Roasty Complex Darkness, according to the label.
Woo! Hey, y'all, watch this.
This is from Athens, Georgia.
Yes. Just pour a little bit more.
Dark. Wow, that is dark as night.
Wow.
It is dark.
It's dark. It's not a billion SRM, but no. It's probably about a million.
Dark, nice frothy head on that. Looks like a...
Head comes out nice.
I know.
That's what she said.
Got a nice smell to it. Ooh, that's a good beer.
Okay, so as we always do in happy beer, is that...
Happy beers.
And happy beers. We'll keep our ratings to ourselves, and we all reveal simultaneously.
We'll yell them all into the microphone. Yeah.
I feel like my entire palate is shot, so...
It should be, like, completely bland. Like,
yeah, but I'm starting to get a little buzzed at that moment.
I get, like, a nutty brown, almost.
Which, I know, it's like...
From, not what I was expecting this.
Like, if we played this game now, I don't know if I'd be able to play.
Subtract like 0.25 for your buzzedness.
A lot of roasted toasted banana.
Yeah, I get some roastiness.
Definitely some roasty toastiness. Yeah,
not a lot. We have to keep the inside jokes out.
Which episode was that?
One of the Flaviar tasters.
Yeah, there's flavors of roasted and toasted.
So I do get a lot of. I get a lot of like. It's not an oatmeal stout. That's for sure. It's definitely just more of just roasted dark malt.
Yeah. I mean, it's not a flavored stout per se. It's just like you were saying. It's a stout.
Yeah,
which is sometimes it's good strip it down to that pure essence of the style.
I like it a lot, but this is a weird way to describe it. It tastes like the beginning of like burnt toast. Like it's got like that
burnt toast.
Yeah, that burnt toast, but like it's not like the full flavor. Like it's not a toasty. It's not a toast flavor. It's just like that. Like if you licked a piece of burnt toast, that's what I would imagine.
I mean, I like it, but it's like when you ruin bread.
You know how good it is when you ruin a good piece of bread.
I need to learn more dark flavors, and I don't know enough of them. I know chocolate.
Well, we know you know your fruits.
Yes,
right.
I got the fruits down. Help me out, guys.
So let's see what Dan thinks.
Yeah. So definitely on the nose, you get the roasted kind of right away. Mm-hmm. Like, and you almost expect this to be. You expect this beer to hit you. Drink it, but. It's actually super smooth. I feel like there's just a really good balanced flavor.
You're going to be surprised when you see the ABV on it.
And I'm honestly not a huge stout person, but I would buy this and I would drink this.
Okay.
This is really, really well balanced. Doesn't leave any... I can't really smell or taste any negative aftertaste or anything like that. It's got a nice strong flavor and then it kind of just...
What did you say you got on the nose? What did you say it smelled like?
Like a roasted, toasted banana.
No. You said, so to me, I got... roasted peanut. Roasted peanut. Like ballpark roasted peanut.
I just feel like it's not that. It's not.
I get a little bit of like a boozy.
It's not boozy nutty scent. Enough to be.
The thing is, I didn't get any peanut flavor, but I did get it on the nose.
I mean, I definitely got. I feel like I got some like toasted nut of some sort, but.
That might be the ABV talking. I don't know what it is yet, but maybe. I do get a slight boozy scent. If I try real hard to smell it, I can get a boozy scent.
Yeah, I mean, it's smooth, but I definitely pick up on the alcohol probably a little heavier than you do.
And maybe for me, peanut just it translates to earthy. You get that ground, that dirty, earthy flavor.
So what do you guys think of it?
There's a little bit of sweetness on the back end I don't think you guys have highlighted it enough.
So as a noob to the pod, mm-hmm. and as a noob to rating beers, I have a hard time rating beers that I haven't had much experience tasting. I haven't had many like dark stouts like this, but this actually surprised me. I would probably give this a 4.
Okay. Yeah, that's solid rating.
It's approaching the 4 for me. It's, you know what? I'm feeling generous today. Todd's getting married 2 days. I'm in a great mood. I'm going to give it a 4.
See, I'm a 3.75.
I'm going to go with a 3.75 as well.
Yeah.
I think the more I get it, and it's a weird flavor to say. Is it like
poopy?
Like Baker's chocolate?
Okay.
I don't know how many people have eaten Baker's chocolate, but like,
well, no, I mean,
what is it? So for maybe, so I'm not familiar with Baker's chocolate. For our audience who might not know what Baker's chocolate is it like really dark cocoa?
Like basically like 100% cacao.
Okay. Yeah.
So yeah, you get a lot more bitterness out of
it. It's a lot of bitter.
I don't get it. Super bitter flavors out of it.
Maybe I don't really know. I'm struggling. I don't know enough dark malt flavors. It's almost like I need my friend.
Yeah, we got
dark malt here to help me out.
Did you invite him to the wedding?
You know, he sent him a message.
Too busy.
He said, he's just too busy.
Yeah, that makes sense.
He's involved in all the beers.
Yeah, I was really curious though if Crystal was showing up.
Crystal was 100% invited.
She was invited to be in the wedding, if you know what I mean.
Is she at my table? just out of curiosity, no particular reason.
You know, I feel like we have to keep you guys separated.
Oh, after the history.
Yeah.
No, it's a good beer. It's a good beer. I like kind of like what Obert was saying, like when you take a stout and you just kind of like just, you're not throwing milk and chocolate and blah and this and vanilla and coffee. It's just nice to have like just a stout every once in a while.
It is the definition of just a stout.
Right. But just a stout isn't bad. Listeners.
I will say like I liked it, but we're popping the next beer there, folks. I would say,
I don't know if I got that.
I will say I liked it. I don't know. Like, I think I'm more of a, like, a flavored stout type of guy.
Yep.
So I probably would just go with a flavored stout next time. But this one, I mean, if you're looking for just a stout and you guys are somewhere near Athens, Georgia, check this out.
So I don't mean to cut you off here, but just coming in with this bourbon barrel aged sticky stout immediately on the pour.
Now, this is more
very
my
quick dissipating head.
Right.
Is it sticky?
I don't know. I mean,
does it taste
like
sticks?
I would stick my finger in it, but.
Yeah, does it taste like sticks, or is it more like molasses?
So the Creature Stout had a really nice head on it, and this one
I'll let you guys decide, but the first word of this beer should definitely be bourbon for bourbon barrel aged. I get that, for sure.
Right.
Nope, he's palate cleanser.
Palate cleanser, but like, maybe this should be part of a recurring segment.
Happy beers?
Todd always has a Bud Light on hand to cleanse the palate.
What do you think, Todd?
There's definitely a lot of bourbon there.
Mm-hmm.
This is an oatmeal stout.
It is an oatmeal stout.
This is 100% oatmeal stout.
Sorry, Dan. Didn't mean to ruin it for you.
I didn't know it was supposed to be a secret.
Yeah.
Definitely a lot of hints of, there's a lot of vanilla. I mean, that's probably from the bourbon. There's a lot of vanilla in there. And that is, I mean, that's a bourbon flavor that you get a lot.
one.
From the you think you get the vanilla flavor, you're saying, from the bourbon barrel more than the actual ingredients of the beer.
Yeah, yeah. Bourbon, I mean, bourbon as a flavor profile, quote unquote, usually has vanilla in there as a flavor.
Sure, sure.
It's one of those flavors that the bourbon gives off.
But you know what? If I was going to brew a beer and put it in a bourbon barrel, it would be one that I would want to put vanilla in to complement that flavor. Yeah. So it might be tough to tell if it's from an added extract or if it's from the barrel.
See, this is interesting. I for sure get the vanilla on the nose. It's almost got that like vanilla booziness. Yeah, I definitely get the vanilla on the nose. And if you've ever cooked with vanilla, and vanilla is extremely boozy smelling.
Right. Yeah.
I get that too. Also. I don't get as much of the bourbon barrel. I might a little bit, but I'm not a bourbon drinker, so that might not just be something I'm used to tasting, but it's not off-putting anyway.
Yeah, I think I speak for the Three Coasts when I say we've all had a fair amount of bourbon barrel beers, and I definitely get strong. I definitely get that, for sure.
The one thing that really threw me for a loop for this one is it's a bourbon barrel stout, but it's very carbonated.
Right, like I couldn't believe how bubbly the beer was. When, like, I almost had interrupted you when you were finishing with your last beer review. It's just like, wow, this head is something you don't see on a lot of bourbon barrel beers.
Yeah,
it's very carbonated.
It's like almost like seltzery. And it's like carbonation. Like, it's up there.
It's like it could have been next to the Bud Lights. No, I'm kidding. But it is that Bud Light level of bubbles.
It's
what do you think, Chris?
It's good.
It's good.
end of synopsis.
Thanks. No.
I definitely get the... And I read the flavor profile on the can. And I'm not going to lie. I don't get a ton of chocolate, which is what it says on the can. I do get vanilla, like it had been said. Yeah, I definitely get a lot of the vanilla that you guys were talking about. There is a sweetness to it, so maybe that's some of the chocolate coming through, but I don't really get straight-up chocolate. Now, it should be said that this beer's kind of cold, so...
This is another one that would be better warmer.
Right.
And that would dissipate some of the carbonation as well.
See, I don't know. I think it's so bubbly. It's unusual.
It is.
It's highly unusual with how bubbly it is.
Right. Like, the last one we did had that nice frothy head that stayed for a while. It was real nice. Mm. This one, I mean, it's like drinking a, like you were saying, like a Bud Light or something like that. Yeah. I mean, at least with the bubbles.
I can get a little bit of the bitterness from the chocolate on the back end, but it's not like, it's not something I would normally have picked up if I didn't read the can and I was actively, like, searching for it
right.
The flavor. It's a good, it's a really good beer. It's really, the carbonation really is funky, though.
So I'm gonna cut in here while everybody comes up with their 0.25 to 5 ratings. And just let the listeners know that this is from Red Hair Brewing Company, which is out of Marietta, Georgia, and Charlotte, North Carolina.
So it's a collab.
No, I think this brewery is located in, has locations in both of those cities.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So if you get a chance, Chris, you know, Red Hair, check it out. I think that
I'll definitely have
this
to.
This is a beer that's worthy of exploring the rest of their lineup for sure.
I would be curious to know what this tastes like on like nitro,
right?
Without the bubbles,
yeah,
that would be interesting. Yeah.
Okay. So does everybody have a rating?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I got one too.
Go first.
Okay. 3.5.
I'm gonna give it a 4.
3.25.
3.5.
Okay. I liked it. I mean, I thought it had. I think the bubbliness is off-putting, but at the same time, the rest of it, and you know, keep in mind, I'm also many, 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 many beers deep at this point.
So, Ted, can you tell me about the bubbliness?
Yeah, how many bubbles per square liter?
So, from 0 to 10, with 0 being water, I put this at probably a 9.62.
You should go with 8, because there's more bubbles than an 8.
Oh.
It's creative comeback.
Okay, let's move on here to everybody's favorite segment. Our sign off, our advice, our wisdom we impart on you, our frosty handle. It's got our frosty
handle. Our frosty handle.
Our frosty handle with 3 bugs attached.
The wisdomy wisdom wisdom of wisdomy wisdom wisdom.
We're pulling the 4 handle mug off the top shelf this week, folks.
Yep.
It's time to end our show like we always do.
So, in commemoration for all the time that we have spent growing up together, from kindergarten for some of you guys, first grade to myself, all the way to graduating from high school, I'm going to propose a theme to today's Frosty Mug of Wisdom handle.
A theme? I wasn't like, ready for
like,
it.
Like, wait, an elementary school themed handle thing?
Correct.
Okay, I'm interested.
I'm glad that you're on board with this.
Yeah, well, tell me more.
So, one thing that I think we can say about each other is that we're all fans of video games.
And I think that fandom was instilled in us as children.
Correct. And I know Dan is a fan of video games as well, although he may not play as many as he used to. But
as kids, we all played a lot of games.
Most of my childhood spent with Dan, we played a lot of video games.
Yeah.
So absolutely. In honor of that, I am going to say, today's handle theme is going to be games that we used to play on elementary school computers.
Okay.
In Mr. Davidson's class.
Okay. So this is going to be a narrow subset, but I do think that there's enough hidden gems out there that hopefully we connect with our audience on stuff that will harken back to those old floppy disk days.
Correct.
Playing games on those computer lab computers.
I mean, A, we're not that old. And B, I think a lot of our listeners, I think we appeal to the demographic who also is more of our age anyways. So I feel like us and our listeners have all played these games in some way, shape, or form throughout our developmental time in our childhood.
So, sure. Okay, so with that,
I'm going to have Dan lead off.
Oh,
ooh, our okay. guest.
As our special guest.
I think we should, I like that. Let's see. So Dan, we were all there in those days where we named our Oregon Trail characters Fart, one of dysentery.
Yeah, so just to clarify, we're talking about games that we played in school. Primarily in school, not games.
We're not
that
talking about Super Mario Brothers,
Super Nintendo.
Yeah, we're not going to pull out
Nintendo 64.
We're not going to pull out Tony Hawk Pro Skater. We used to enter the cheat code and electrical tape the N64 controller to the left so he'd keep on grinding for hours.
Just because I was better than you,
not that
doesn't mean
Todd's bitter about it at all. He's clearly gotten over this. By the way.
Or Dan did a cheat code to make Ken Griffey Jr. hit a home run every time he got up to the plate.
Yeah.
Hey, okay,
so he only comes up once every 9 years.
So we're talking edutainment here from back in the day. What do you got for us?
Okay, so as a young child going to computer class, I always look forward to being able to play this game called Gizmos and Gadgets.
Oh, nice.
Ooh. Now, Gizmos and Gadgets
That's cool.
was released first on DOS 3.3 and later released on Windows 95. All of you remember that high quality operating system.
Oh, yeah.
I think we had Apple.
Windows 95. We did. We had, and Macintosh. Okay. I'm on Wikipedia right now. But Gizmos and Gadgets was an awesome game because it taught you as a kid simple machines like levers and pulleys and stuff like that, magnets, basic electronics, and different forms of energy. You would basically collect parts to a little car. And of different quality and different style and whatnot. And then once you got all the parts together to race this mad scientist guy, you put your car together.
Would you call like a gizmo or like maybe like a gadget?
Along those lines.
Okay.
You know, plus or minus. And yeah, so if your car won, you beat the mad scientist guy, you move on to the next level, and it gets progressively harder. There are monkeys involved, and bananas, and the bananas put the monkey to sleep. So there was just some, like, playfulness involved in this game. But overall, that was probably my favorite game to play in computer class. Nice. Gizmos and Gadgets.
That's a good one.
Part of me wonders if this is what started Obert's love with engineering way back in the day.
It could be, you know. You know, you never know what was the spark, but for all I know, it could have been Gizmos and Gadgets.
Released in 1993.
Nice.
All right, you were fine.
Yeah.
Awesome.
So, yeah, I'm going to take this awesome four-handed mug, and I'm going to pass it over to Mr. Tuck.
I was hoping to pass it to Chris.
The Bachelor.
Drink plenty from this frosty mug here.
My handle is going to be Math Blaster, Episode 1, In Search of Spot. So, it was a game that came out in 1994, and it was released on DOS, Windows, Macintosh, SNES, and Sega Genesis. I did not know about SNES and Sega Genesis. It was rated ages 6 to 9, so we were right in the age group,
nice.
Considering it came out in 1994, and as we just learned, in 1995 we were 5, so perfect for 6. So, the plot was Spot and Blasternaut are preparing for a journey aboard their spaceship, only to find the ship is not functional. So basically, you went through a whole bunch of different math problems and tried to build the ship up to operational standards so it could operate.
He's just painting such a beautiful picture with your words.
Yo, it was so AKA, it's basically like a math simulator to help you learn how to do math, and while keeping the game fun. It was a lot more fun than, say, like Turbo Supercharged Racer, where there was no end to the game.
Turbo Math X.
Yeah, Turbo Math X. There we go. Math Blaster had an end. There was an ending to the game. I think that was the only game in school I ever finished to completion. So that's my favorite game. So with that, I'm going to hand the mug over to Ober.
All right. Thank you. I spent a lot of mornings, cold New England mornings, avoiding outdoor morning recess in the cold months of January and December. In the computer lab playing Amazon Trail.
Nice.
Which That's is, a good one. Yeah, it's a knockoff of Oregon Trail. The whole premise is you're in the rainforest and you have to like photograph rare species. And as opposed to in Oregon Trail, you would go hunting and shoot all the buffalo. In Amazon Trail, you would go spearfishing and you have to click on all the fish.
Yep.
And there was always like the one that looked huge and moved slow, and it was the lock, and it'd break your spear. But that was another game, you know, I don't know if I ever got all the way to the very end, because it was a long game, and, you know, I was listening back to last week's episode, which I wasn't a part of, but we talked about having, not being able to save video games, and a lot of computer class was playing games from the very beginning. But Amazon Trail was a great one.
That's a certain hell that I don't want to go back to.
Not being able to save games or computer or cold morning recess outside.
I still have to deal with those cold morning recesses, but it's now walking to work. But no, not being able to save a game.
Yeah. No, thank goodness saving is a thing. But yeah, I love me a good Amazon Trail. And I hope that our listeners out there, a few of them at least, can recognize Amazon Trail and enjoyed it as well.
Yeah, it's a good one. I enjoyed that one quite a bit.
I always enjoyed that game, but it was always frustrating. You can only get so far in one 40-minute
Exactly. Yeah, and maybe that's why it's my handle today, because I was like Sisyphus pushing that boulder up a hill. I would get so far, and then I would be restart next time. And it just buried in my brain. But okay, there's only one person who needs to add beer to this frosty handle of mug, and that's Chris.
Alright, so I feel bad because I feel like one of the most overrated games is going to go unsaid. But this was a game.
I was about to yell at you and say, do not just take the easy way out and go with the one that everybody's thinking.
Oh no! I'm like, that one's going to be missing, and I'm just like,
well, we're gonna.
I know.
I can wrap this up. Don't worry.
Oh, I'm worried. No, mine is often forgotten by most, including myself at sometimes, but it's The Secret Island of Dr. Quandary.
I love that game.
Yeah, okay.
I was hoping that somebody's going to bring that one up.
I love this game, and I didn't...
Stupid triangle building with the tires. Oh,
I can tell you I've never beaten it. I know.
No, me neither.
I know I've never beaten it.
Like, that game to 10-year-old Brennan's brain was, like, trying to solve complex algebra. Like, there was no way I was going to get anywhere near the end of that game.
How long do you think it would take us now to beat this game?
I don't know if I could.
15 minutes.
Yeah, I think we would crush these games.
Take that. No, this game was a lot of fun. I mean, Amazon Trail is a pretty close second for me, I'm not going to lie. But it was a lot of fun. You pick like this weird, you're on this weird island, you pick a weird ass doll that you are.
Yeah, that was the difficulty.
Yeah. And you just play through the game. It's a bunch of like logical math problems, and it's matching and, you know, moving things.
It was edutainment mixed with RPG of inventory collecting stuff and trying to solve these puzzles.
Yeah, it was a lot, and I know I've never beaten it. I probably never gotten past like the first like, I don't know, a few puzzles, because we only had so many hours to play. But I remember every time I had free time or whatever, I would always try and play that game. And got nowhere. But actually, I'm going to see if I can download it.
Of all the games to talk about today, that's the one that I most want to find an emulator for.
So what was the name of this game?
Dr. Quandary's.
Yeah, it's The Secret Island of Dr. Quandary.
But... So, Chris, when you said that, I thought to myself, I have no idea what he's talking about. And now I'm looking at screenshots of this game. I distinctly remember this game. And looking at these screenshots again, like, this is a very trippy game.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is a weird game.
Yeah.
So, So, Chris, do you want some good news?
Sure.
Or some bad news?
I guess I'm going to get both.
So it is the same news for both of them. There is a website. This is the ultimate handle of the day. Called ClassicReload.com.
Okay.
We'll put a link in it in the show description where you can download over 6,000 DOS and or Windows and console games preserved for future generations. Dr. Quandary's is on there.
Okay.
As is the one that we said that we weren't going to end up mentioning on the pod, the Oregon Trail.
Yeah. Oh, I thought you were talking about Turbo Math Blaster.
So Turbo Math Facts. So is Civilization 1, Prince of Persia.
Okay, Todd, but you promised me good news and bad news, and so far it's been good news, and good
well,
news.
Well, I felt bad because I feel bad for CJ.
Why is that?
Because his dad's going to be spending the next year and a half trying to be, Dr. Quandary, that he's not going to have time to spend with CJ.
What's the name of that site?
ClassicReload.com. So ultimately, this is the ultimate handle.
Oh my God, it has number markers.
You guys might as well put your sign-offs now, because we're about to lose Chris.
And so with that, there are way too many beers on today's podcast to mention, so we're just going to hop back to the original four beers that we drank. So I'm going to go first in thanking Trillium for the Melker Street India Pale Ale.
Nepco Baby Bot.
Thank you to Mumford Brewing for the Pine Berry Milkshake Style Double IPA.
And thank you to Primal Brewing for the Lemon Haze Pale Ale.
We'd like to ask you guys all to go onto our social media and follow us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Untappd.
Wait, hang on. This has been a long episode. Social media, email, listen, general thoughts.
Give me 10 seconds. Please follow us on all social media at Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and Untappd at DAWF Podcast. Please send us emails at DAWFpodcast@gmail.com. Please go on iTunes and rate us 5 stars, obviously, because this is an awesome episode. And please click on our Amazon affiliate link for anything that we ever post. Also, please go on Patreon and subscribe right away. Chris really does want to drink the Chelada beer from Bud Light. Obviously, after I've hit 2 for 2 today, he's even more inspired to drink more Bud Light product.
No.
And with that,
email in and let me know which outro you preferred, mine or Tuts.
And thank you to Brandon. Thank you for the beers.
Of course. We
cannot forget Brandon. And anybody else who's ever sent this beer, obviously, and thank you. Special shout out to Jordan last week. Thanks for subbing in for Obert. I feel like you should have given that. Thank you, Obert. But
at the same time,
don't worry. I'm going to give it to him for anyways. So with that, my name's Tud.
My name's Chris.
I'm Obert.
And I'm Dan. And remember, if you're drinking alone, do it.
Woohoo!
Guys, we got a lot of bush in Bud Light to drink.
Chris, scoot you up. How's this download coming?
I haven't found it yet.
We're about to... Oh, no! Oh, no! Oh, no!